now we will be discussing how will heat transfer will happen in electronic devices. So heat transfer in electronic devices is no different than other devices. Here we have the same heat transfer modes, that are conduction, convection, and radiation. And to understand the heat flow in any device, you have to understand the concept of thermal resistance. So those who have took a basic heat transfer course in the undergraduate may be aware of this thermal resistance concept. So what it does is similar to the electrical resistance. The pathway of heat is characterized by different thermal resistance. Now, as I told that in the system thermal design, you have to throw the heat away from the silicon dioxide to ambient, and that path of heat flow involves things like heat spreading, and you have to pass through irregular contacts. So all of these give rise to different resistance to the heat flow, and those are characterized by two different resistance. So one is the spreading resistance, and the other is the contact resistance. Let's first discuss what is spreading resistance. So here in this diagram, you can see we have this heat source, which is of a smaller area, and you are dissipating the heat from that smaller source into a large area. And that large area may be connected to a heat sink through a fan, or may not be connected to a heat sink, so it can be anything. The main thing we need to understand is when the heat goes from this source to this spreader, the tendency of the heat is to flow in the Z direction. However, what we desire, what is desirable is that the heat spreads through this uniformly. And for that purpose, there are the thermal solutions here include heat spreaders. So these heat spreaders do not have an isotropic thermal conductivity. They have different thermal conductivity in this plane and in the Z plane. So they have higher planar conductivities and lower Z conductivities. What that does is reduce this thermal resistance and spreads the heat uniformly through this spreader. Apart from that, the spreading resistance also keeps on increasing if you keep these sources at uncomfortable locations, like at the corners. Then also the spreading resistance increases. So to minimize the spreading resistance in the electronic devices, you have to do what you have to do is uniformly spread the heat sources and try to center them as much as possible. The other thing is contact resistance. Now, when the heat is flowing through the electronic device, there you will see a lot of contacts, because it will be essentially an assembly of many components. So you will see a lot of contacts. And those contacts may be looking like this. So for 1 second, if you assume that the TIM is not there, then how the heat will flow from material one to material two? So heat will come in from here, and it will see this peak. So what will happen? The heat will get constricted, and that constriction is called constriction resistance. And after that constriction, again, it will pass from here to material two, and then it will expand. That means you will observe a spreading resistance kind of phenomenon here. Apart from that, when you when this material one and material two are connected, there is air between them, and that air will also create a resistance. So that all those resistance to the heat flow is combined called as contact resistance. And to reduce this contact resistance, the solution which we use are thermal interface material, thermal paste, gel. So these are all different kind of materials which enable higher Z conductivity, so that the contact resistances are minimized. Now, in the microprocessor evolution phase from 1970s to say 2010, we did not observe any major thermal challenges, and minimizing contact resistance and spreading resistance was sufficient enough, along with say a heat sink and a fan, was sufficient enough to cool majority of the devices. Also, the power densities which we observed were not as high. So let's discuss about this conventional techniques. So the first is heat sink and fan. So this is more commonly seen in the Intel CPUs, wherein the power is high, but the power densities are not necessarily high. And that this heat sink and fan, what they do is try to remove the heat from your electronic device to the outside ambient through natural convection, through forced convection. And there have been improvements in this where by using the CPU areas, it can be enabled through natural convection as well. So here I have shown a diagram which makes you understand the heat flow in an electronic device using this thermal resistance. So this is TJ, which is the temperature of the component. And RJO, it is a package resistance. RTIM, this is the resistance of the TIM. RS is the the resistance of the heat sink. R conduction, this is the resistance of the fin due to conduction. And then we have this R convection, which is the resistance due to convection to the outside ambient. And this, most probably this is forced in most of the Intel CPUs. And apart from that, let's have a look at these. So this is an integrated heat spreader, which has a very high planar conductivity, and it enables very good spreading in the electronic devices. We have this thermal grease or paste. It is available in form of tube, which can be applied on the packages. And this enables a very high Z conductivity. So these are all the conventional techniques. Now, these were sufficient with low power density applications, but with the increase in power densities, these solutions are required, but they are not sufficient. So let's talk about those non-conventional technologies. So first, we will talk about heat pipe. Now here I have shown an example of a heat pipe in a laptop. So what is a heat pipe basically? So heat pipe is a device which is working on two-phase cooling technique. So you have this heat pipe and you have a liquid inside this heat pipe. Now what happens? This heat pipe is placed on the device, on the silicon die. And this contact is usually one-dimensional. That is, you are not placing it completely over the device. So only a one-dimensional contact is made there. And then the liquid inside the heat pipe absorbs the heat, and that liquid then turns into the vapor and it transfers to the other side, from where you can dissipate the heat to the outside system. And then that vapor again turns into the liquid and it comes back to its original location using capillary action. So there are wicks inside this heat pipe to make sure that the capillary action takes place and the liquid comes back to its original place and keep on transferring the heat. Now, this is very good for high power density applications, but if the power densities are a lot higher, then it becomes insufficient to use heat pipes also because of the 1D heat transfer. In that case, we use a very similar technology, but in a 2D direction. So that is called vapor chamber. So here also the transfer of heat takes place through a two-phase cooling technique, but the connectivity between the heat source and the thermal solution is two-dimensional and it ensures a better heat spreading. However, when you want to select a thermal solution for your device and you are comparing heat pipe and vapor chamber for that, then the major considerations which come up is the cost, because the vapor chambers are far costlier than heat pipes. So you have to see whether you are getting your desired performance improvement after using the vapor chamber, or if the heat pipes, if the performance which you are getting using heat pipes is sufficient enough, then you can go with a heat pipe because that will save you a lot of cost. The third technology which I want to discuss is the TEM. So here we do not have any liquid and it is only in solid state. Now what is TEM? TEM is thermoelectric cooling solution. Now, the thermoelectric phenomenon you may have read in your 12th physics, the Seebeck phenomenon, Peltier phenomenon. So this is based on a Peltier phenomenon. That is when you put current across this device. What happens? One side is heat is absorbed and the other side heat is rejected. And the solution, the device which you have to cool, you will put it on the cold side. And what will happen is on the cold side, it will absorb the heat and it will reject through the hot side. Here, this device, this thermal solution is helpful for applications where you need very high reliability. You do not want the temperature to be varying too much. You want silent operations, noise free. So yeah, so one example you can think of is space application where this can be used. Now the limitation of this technology is the lower thermodynamic efficiency. That means they do not do enough cooling for the amount of energy you are providing. And this can be commercialized for other applications, other common applications, once there are advances in the material, which will lead to higher thermodynamic efficiency. So these are the three technologies which I have discussed in brief. Apart from this, there are many technologies like aerogels, which are used for reducing the contact resistance. There is immersion cooling, and there are phase change materials. There are many thermal solutions. So you can, there is a lot of literature available on Google. You can find out what are those solutions and where they are used, what are the applications, what advantages, disadvantages. So all of that, you can have a look at it. Okay, so now let's talk about another important factor from a thermal design point of view. So that is thermal packaging. Now, what is packaging? First, you need to understand. So what packaging does is represents a way of connecting the microprocessor to the motherboard. Now, in an electronic device, the silicon die is not the only thing. You have, so I will give you the example of a smartphone. So in a smartphone, there is a PCB. On that PCB, you have a silicon die. And that silicon die needs to talk with other components on the motherboard, that is the PCB. So these components may be the PMIC, which is the charger chip, which provides the power to the die to perform the functions. You will have a WLAN chip, which will enable any Wi-Fi related applications to be performed at the silicon die. You will have your memory, the UFS memory or the eMMC. So all these components are housed on the motherboard, and it is very essential that your silicon die is connected to the motherboard, and package enables you to connect this silicon die to the motherboard. Now, from the advent of this electronics, specifically the IC integrated circuits, the packaging was primarily for this connecting the microprocessor to motherboard. But now it has evolved into a discipline of optimization. Now you do not need to look only at the connectivity to the motherboard. You have to look at various other factors. That is, that involves mechanical. So you have to see whether the package is not bending, whether you have to shield that from the electromagnetic radiation. And you have to make sure that the materials in the package are good enough to not resist the path of the heat flow too much. So all of those considerations are very important today. So let's just discuss about what kind of thermal characterization of packages is done. So in the timeline of 1990s, the thermal characterization of packages began to happen at a standardized level. So there was ZX standard set up by a JC15 committee, And those standards outline what kind of resistance you can need to calculate in a package to understand the thermal behavior of a package. And the package thermal engineers are responsible to make sure that the package materials have a good conductivity, they have adequate layers in the substrate, and they are designed for a very optimized thermal performance. So let me just walk you through a kind of evaluation of a packaging from the 1970s to 2010s. So in the 1970s, the primary technologies were dual inline package, hot plate package. So these did not involve any kind of a thermal challenge. So the real thermal challenge started to come place from this ball grid arrays. And in the same time, the JEDEC committee suggested the JEDEC standards. And then one of the important development is in the 2000s, that is the system in package. Now, there are a lot of blocks in the electronic device that like CPU, GPU. So earlier these blocks were separated. So you have separate ICs for CPU, for GPU, for modem. And during 2000s, what was done? All these separate blocks were housed in a single package. So before 2000s, all these blocks were separated. They were handled by separate packages. But in 2000s, all of these blocks were housed in a single package. After that, system in package became to SoC, that is system on chip. So all these blocks are now on a single chip. So your CPU, GPU are no longer different ICs. They are housed on a single die. And with that, the advent in package on package kind of technologies came in. So here in package on package, we have two silicon dies which host SoC, that is system on chip. And one of them holds a logic, the other holds a memory, and that is a kind of package. And with this package on package, the thermal challenges in packaging increased significantly. And the package engineers were up from head to toes in designing, in understanding the material behavior for these packages and making sure that the heat is dissipated adequately. And now we are moving towards even more challenging technologies like the 3D ICs. Here you have two SoCs, that is you have say CPU on top and GPU on the bottom SoC, and those two SoCs with very high power consumption will be housed together. So already the 3D ICs, although they have not come into the market pretty much, but the future of packaging lies in the 3D IC. Okay, so that's all from the packaging. Let's move on to the next. So let's now discuss about the tools and techniques used for thermal analysis. Now, to do all this thermal design management and package thermal characterization, you need to do a lot of thermal analysis. So let's discuss about the kind of tools and techniques which are used for thermal analysis. So first we will discuss about the EDA software. EDA means the electronic design and analysis. So before creating a thermal model where you want to run your CFD simulation, you need to first you need to first capture the electrical behavior of critical components like PCB, package, the substrate, trace layers. So all of those can be done through the Ansys electronic suite, which hosts a lot of softwares designed for that purpose. Then comes the CAD tools. So the CAD tools are used for the mechanical design. So all the electronic components are converted into simple mechanical blocks using SpaceClaim and Ansys Designer. And once you have the thermal model ready using your CAD tools and EDA softwares, then the CFD tools come into picture. So we have two popular CFD tools. One is Ansys iSpec, other is Mentor Graphics Flowthumb. So the advantage of these softwares is they have a very custom library of thermal solutions like heat sinks. And it is very easy to design a thermal model in these tools. And for example, iSpec is very popularly used because it also, the solver involved here is Ansys Fluent, which is also very popular in the CAE industry. Now, the flow for CFD is very common, but apart from that, when you do thermal analysis, it may happen that you need to do a lot of optimization studies. wherein you will see that whether the floor plan is optimized or not, whether you can explore different floor plan options on the die. So there are many optimization studies. And if you run CFD simulations using iSpec Flowtherm, they consume a lot of runtime. One steady state simulation will take about 1 hour, and a transient simulation will take about 6-7 hours. So if you say want to run 50-60 simulations for your project, then it will take months to complete your what if studies. But that that much amount of time is not available for thermal engineer in the industry. So what you have to do, how this problem is addressed using ROM techniques. So ROM is reduced order modeling. What you do is the information which is there in the CFD, that is captured into a reduced order linear model. And for that, you run one single simulation, which runs for 2-3 days. And once you run this simulation for 2-3 days, the rest 60-70 simulations which you want to run for your what if studies, that can be run through this linear model, and that will take only a day. And two popular techniques which are used are convolution and state space based LTI modeling. So anyone interested in this ROM, they can just search about these topics, convolution and state space, and you will find a lot of papers and material on this. So this ROM technique is also used in electric vehicle analysis, and it is very popular in the industry. So now let's move on to the final slide for our webinar, where we will discuss what kind of career options are available. Now, there are a lot of career opportunities in this space, and the companies which look to hire thermal engineers are semiconductor industries. There are many OEMs, there are many startups which are working on thermal solutions. We have the software companies who provide the consulting to these industries. So they need application engineers. So there are many career opportunities existing. So earlier the trend was most of these jobs were not available in India, but in the past few years, many jobs have been moving out of USA into India, and there are a lot of opportunities. So let's just discuss a few roles. So one is SOC level thermal analysis. So I am working in this role. So this role, what is needed to be done here is floor plan optimizations, sensor placements, benchmark. So there are many benchmarks for different devices. For example, for smartphone, we have Antutu, Geekbench. So all of these benchmarks. So you need to understand how much these benchmarks are throttling due to thermal. So all of those analysis is covered in the SOC level thermal. Then we have the system level thermal design. So these engineers, what they do, they take a product and design the thermal solution for that from scratch. And this is the most challenging job, as you need to come up with innovative ways to cool the device with the cost available and the power envelope available. Apart from that, we have this package thermal engineer. So this job involves the thermal optimization of package, as I discussed in the thermal packaging slide. Then we have customer engineering department. So there are thermal engineers also required to interact with customers. So they have custom tools made where they use the data from other engineers and they present it in a certain format to the customer so that he can understand how the thermal is looking like for the device. Apart from that, we have a data center thermal engineer. So these thermal engineers will be working on those big cooling system. And typically companies like Amazon, Facebook, they hire data center thermal engineers for their data centers which store this big data. And there are many opportunities in the software companies, as I told, application engineer who provide consulting to these industries. So they solve the customer's problem. So if someone is stuck with some kind of thermal analysis or something new thing is coming up, new physics phenomenon is coming up. So all of those things are handled by those application engineers. So yeah, with this, I am concluding the webinar. So, yeah. So question